Turn with me in your Bibles today to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. We've been looking at 21st century Christianity. In other words, Christianity today. Remember, there's a magazine out, isn't there? Christianity Today. And I always like that magazine whenever I run into it. I don't subscribe to it, but whenever I find it somewhere, I always pick it up and read it, because Christianity Today is we want to know what's going on today. You know, we learn from our past so that we can operate and function in our present so we can make a better future for next generations. Amen? This is what we do. We're trying to create the best atmosphere today based on what we know from the past so that we can provide a better future for the next generations of the church. And so Christianity Today, or 21st century Christianity, as I've called this series of messages, is about living for God today. Not next year, not the year after that, but today. And far too often we think, you know, well, I'll get it together next week. I'll get it together down the road. And you know what? Getting it together sometimes is hard. Amen?
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to do sometimes. And it's a challenge for us to get together sometimes, or get it together. But in the second book of Peter here, we realize that Peter is talking to a church that is in a growth and development stages. And there was things that were going on outside the church in 1 Peter. And in 2 Peter, he deals with things that are going on inside the church. And there's a lot of growth and development in 1 and 2 Peter that, if you want to read it through, there's a tremendous amount of stuff that's pointed at us. But I want to focus today on a few things here. But let's just read this before we get going, because I'm going to look at the entire chapter before we're done today, just as an overview. I don't have time to preach the whole book in its finite detail, but let's take a look at this. He says, "Beloved, I now write to you this second epistle." This is 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. "The second epistle, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, and saying, 'Where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. For this they willfully forget, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in water, by which the world that then existed perished, being flooded with water. But the heavens and the earth, which are now preserved by the same word, are reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, do not forget this one thing." Don't you hate that when somebody says that to you? It's generally the thing you'll forget, right? He says, don't forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. You know, we can build all kinds of doctrines around, you know, a day is like 1,000 years with the Lord. But he also says 1,000 years is as one day, or a day is 1,000 years is as one day. I believe what he's saying to us is that time is irrelevant with God. Time is irrelevant. Timing is not irrelevant with God, because he sets things in motion to bring about something in a specific time. But time in general does not exist in God. We base it on time because we only have a lease on life. We're here for a certain period of time, and then we're gone. And hopefully we move on to be with God if we have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord. But at the end of the day, he's saying time is irrelevant with God. We need to focus on what he wants us to do right now. Don't forget this thing, that time is irrelevant with God, that we need to focus on where we are at today. "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the Lord, of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot and blameless. And consider that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand, which untaught and unstable people twist to their own destruction, as they do also the rest of scriptures. You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked, but grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. A lot in there. Again, I could probably preach for several weeks just on what is in this one passage of Scripture alone. But as Peter begins to draw his letter to a close, we find that within this last chapter, you will have a warning and an exhortation and an encouragement, where he warns us of certain things, he exhorts us about certain things, and then he encourages us in the end. You know, he takes the time to make sure that the reader of his book is informed about the plans and the agendas of God, that the purposes of God shine through in the midst of this. And, he makes note that the world will be full of scoffers. It's interesting. You know, the world is definitely full of scoffers, aren't they? I mean, we have scoffers from literally every community on the planet. I mean, we have scoffers against our faith in the educational systems, in the political systems, in whatever system you have. There is people that will like to come against our faith in Jesus Christ. There's a worldview that challenges our very belief system. So what I like so much about this Truth Project teaching is that he presents a worldview. How, as Christians, should we see the world, and what is there in the world that we can help, that we can deal with, that we can walk with? There's this worldview that Peter talks about in the first six verses of this chapter. And he points out some things in here. He says that they walk according to their own lust. This is the world. They walk according to their own lust. I mean, let's face it, when before we were redeemed, we walked and just did whatever we wanted to do, didn't we? I did. I don't know about you, but I did. I just did whatever I wanted to do. They have their own ways. They have their own agendas. They have their own thoughts. People don't think along the lines of godly things. Somebody once said to me, well, before you were saved, didn't you believe that there was a God? Well, of course I believed there was a God. I was an outdoorsy person. I could look at the creation of God and say, yeah, I believe there's a God, but I did not know him. I didn't know anything about him. I had no understanding of how I could even possibly access him. So from one day to the next, I never really gave God a thought. I never thought about it. I did not know that you could have a personal relationship with the Heavenly Father. So I did not think about it. I thought about the things that I wanted to do. I walked according to my own lust, my own agendas. He says in this worldview, they'll scoff at the idea of Christ's return. They'll scoff at that. In fact, they even say in here, nothing ever changes. You know, you've been talking about his return all along the way, but nothing has changed. He still hasn't returned. Nothing has happened yet. This is what the world says. This is written nearly 2,000 years ago, or around 2,000 years ago, and we still have the same problem today. People say, well, where is God? How come Jesus hasn't returned yet? Well, we got to drop down the page a little bit to where he says, remember, a day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. Time is irrelevant with God. If 2,000 years has passed according to our clock, then that's just the way it is. The timing of God is not right yet for Jesus to return, although many preachers today, I being one of them, believe that we are moving into a last days stage. How long that takes us to get through that again is in the hands of God, not in the hands of Morris. And so I have to continue to live today. And today is the 21st century, and so I am concerned with where the church is at today. I am concerned with what we're about today. Are we fulfilling the agenda of God? Are we walking out the plans of God today? This is what we have to focus on. He says here, he points out that they actually willfully forget about what God has done. They willfully forget about what God has done. Yeah, I call this the Pharaoh's syndrome, right? You say, why that? Well, you know, in the Pharaoh's, one of them would take over. They would go and they would chisel all the names of all the other Pharaohs off the temples and off the pillars and everything. And so some of the Pharaohs we know very little about because their successor went and chiseled their name off of everything. They just willfully wanted to forget what the guy before them did, so they chiseled his name off of everything. And I think that's the way our society is today. They willfully want to forget about the things of God, so they want to take the Ten Commandments out of everywhere. They want to take the Bibles out of the libraries. They want to take them out of the schools. They want to take them out of... They want to willfully forget what God has done in the world today. I call it the Pharaoh's syndrome. You can call it whatever you want. Foolish would be another word for it. But at the end of the day, God will be God, and man will know about him. That's what will happen, because he will make sure. All the attempts to destroy God's word, and it is still the number one bestseller in the world. And it seems like the more they come against the word of God, the more proliferated the word of God becomes. You realize that the Gideons, you're all familiar with who the Gideons are, right? I just love the Gideons. You know, and one of them, a Gideon, said to me, he said, one of the problems we're having today is that we're just a bunch of old guys talking about the Bible in people's minds. And people forget that we have now put into circulation over 1 billion Bibles. The Gideons alone, over 1 billion Bibles. I cannot tell you how many languages they are translated into today, but you can go just about anywhere in the world. And I have traveled a lot of the world, and in virtually every hotel room I have ever been in, I open up a drawer, and there is a Gideon Bible. And I go... Incredible. I have seen them in Spanish, in the Philippines. I saw them in Tagalog, and you know, on and on it goes. And so the word of God will continue to proliferate. So no matter what man does, they can try to chisel the name of God off of everything they want, but it's just a willful forgetfulness. God will not be forgotten. The world's view says that there is no God and that nothing has ever happened will ever really prove that he did exist or even exists today. Again, this is a form of willful amnesia. And Peter points to the flood. He points to the flood and says, the flood proves it. The flood proves that God said there was going to be one, and there was one, and we have been recovering from it ever since. And, you know, I love Chilliwack because you just look around the whole city, and it's just surrounded by mountains. And there's something majestic about mountains, isn't there? You know, my friend Gary is from Swift Current, where I can guarantee you there is no mountains. I have been there. In fact, you can watch your dog run away for 3 days. It's just like, one of the pastors out there in Regina told me, he said, if you stand on a chair, you can see the back of your head. And so it's like, but in Chilliwack, that is not the case. In Chilliwack, you're just looking around, it's just mountains everywhere, and there's a majesty to all of that. Amen? And it's hard to imagine that what we're looking at is actually the destroyed version. What did it look like before the flood? What was the earth like before the flood? What was it like before the canopy collapsed and it was tropical from coast or from pole to pole and all around, and the temperature was an even 84 degrees with, you know, 70% humidity? Life must have been tough. And in one swift move, the canopy came down, and over 40 days and 40 nights, that collapse and the wells of the earth exploded up and the rains came down. Wow. And for 400 and some days, Noah and his family floated in that ark, and one day it came to rest on a mountain. I had a lady challenge me about, you know, the way the world has been populated, about how, you know, every group should just stay where they came from.